Okay, before we go, get you to Bracketology, some final thoughts on the men's tournament. Andy, you want to talk about Villanova?
Yeah, I think Villanova ended up getting the toughest bracket. When you look at this, they've got the Big Ten regular season champ in Ohio State, the SEC tournament champ in Florida, the ACC runner-up in Boston College, and also Jerry McNamara put Syracuse into the tournament, but the way it looks right here, his three-pointer sent Cincinnati to the NIT.
I got a thought on Duke. You know, we look at the brackets, and a lot of this comes down to matchups. Duke's got a heck of a second game if they take on George Washington. This is a very talented team. If Pops Mensah-Bonsu is healthy, look out, because George Washington is going to give them all they want. Plus, Duke's got a quick turnaround. They play on Thursday. They look like a tired team coming down the stretch. They get a very hard-fought win over Boston College. It's not a walk in the park for Duke just because they're the number one overall seed.
And I'll tell you this, Doug. Duke, I thought, got a tougher number two seed, even though they're number one overall, with Texas, a team that they played earlier in the season, a little revenge factor. Then Connecticut, which is the second number two, they got Tennessee as a number two.
Yeah, well, I think Memphis is a perfect sign of what the selection committee is sending out signals for future years. Number two out of conference strength of schedule. They won their league. They lose one game in a hostile environment at UAB. And by the way, I think Memphis got a great draw because the one team in their bracket early on that could get them is Kansas, but they're also a young team. We saw Kansas. They played a marvelous basketball game today. But I think Memphis, the only weakness is their lack of experience in the NCAA tournament. Without Rodney Carney, there is no one on this roster that has played an NCAA tournament game.
Right.
They'll get a chance to kind of get their rhythm, get their feel. Look out for Memphis getting to that Final Eight.
All right, you guys have obviously been through the brackets. National champion.
I think UConn has an absolute walk to the Final Four, and you put them in the big environment where they play their best. I like UConn to win the whole thing.
Andy?
I agree. I mean, UConn's loss in the Big East tournament certainly motivated this group. It's given Jim Calhoun really the buttons to push right now. I like the Huskies.
Wow, we agree. How about that?
All right. Well, we help you fill out your brackets, even gave you the champion. That's all we have here on Sports.
ESPNU Bracketology, presented by Staples.
The field of 65 is set for the NCAA tournament, though a couple of my colleagues might want to take continuing studies in bracketology to figure out a couple of things that happen. Glad to have you along. Rece Davis alongside Digger Phelps and the always satisfying Jay Bilas. Dick Vitale called the Duke-Boston College game, the ACC tournament. He is on his way, and we'll save a seat for him at the end to talk about what happened. Hey, we've got an hour, guys. Let's get it cranked up with the number one overall seed in the tournament. In the Atlanta part of the bracket, the number one overall seed and a number one seed for the ninth time in 10 years. Duke will open play in Greensboro on Thursday against Southern. Jay, your impressions of the top part of this Atlanta region?
Well, I think Duke's in good shape in their first couple of games. George Washington, you can tell the committee was not impressed with their schedule, giving them an eight seed. They're playing a UNC Wilmington team that can beat them. UNC Wilmington can shoot it, they can spread the floor, and if they handle the ball against that GW defense, they've got a chance to win that ball game.
Let's talk about Syracuse. Is Cinderella still wearing orange? Well, you know, it could be that way. I just think the Cuse has got a lot of things going for itself. Jerry McNamara and company got it done in Madison Square Garden. They lost the last three games of the regular season, but McNamara says we're not going to lose in New York after game one when he hit the big three to knock off Cincinnati. He just put himself in a position to say, let's keep it going, fellas. I thought Nichols, Roberts, and Watkins really played to their potential. Now they've got confidence going into this matchup, but I think more importantly is Jerry McNamara is not done with his tour of duty, as they know now playing against a Texas A&M is a type of team they won't have to worry about going up and down, so they're still a little bit resting after getting off playing four straight games. But more importantly, I think they're in a position now to move forward and play the way they did in New York. It's a big carryover effect, Jeff.
They better not take Texas A&M lightly, because Texas A&M is a good team, despite the fact that Texas A&M did not play a very good non-conference schedule. This team can play. Joseph Jones inside is an absolute load. He can give you 30. AC Law on the perimeter, a left-hander, a quality basketball player. I don't think think Texas A&M has seen the kind of zone they're going to see against Syracuse. Right. The one thing in this region, LSU is a really dangerous team in the second round for Syracuse if they are to get past Texas A&M. And LSU would be a nightmare for Duke in the Sweet 16 because of their size inside. Assuming that Tyrus Thomas comes back and is the big-time athlete he can be, that's a team that can beat them badly.
And
on
that's
glass.
Been the problem with Duke. Points in the paint like Boston College, 44-26, and that's how Duke's lost with teams beating them up inside.
Yeah, Tyrus Thomas has had a high ankle sprain. John Brady held him out of the SEC tournament, expected to be ready to go when the Tigers start up in the NCAA tournament. The bottom part of the Atlanta region, West Virginia made a run to the Elite Eight last year. They are a sixth seed. They'll open against the Salukis, one of four Missouri Valley teams that got in.
Well, you can tell Iowa and West Virginia, they did not get the best possible draw here because those are two difficult styles to play against. Southern Illinois is very good defensively. This team can switch every screen led by Jamal Tatum. They don't care about matchups, and they're going to have to switch every screen in order to stay with the three-point shooters of West Virginia. The key is, can Southern Illinois score enough points? I'm not sure that they can. Iowa is playing terrific basketball. They're very good defensively, and they're a senior-dominated team. That's where they're going to have an edge. All those seniors, Jeff Horner, Adam Haleska, Greg Bruner, then the bottom of that bracket is really strong. California and NC State played in the first round of the 2003 tournament, a game that went to overtime. Richard Midgley played in that game. He remembers North Carolina State, and I think Texas has a very good draw to get back and perhaps play again against Duke in a regional final.
Well, Texas has a two seed playing the Ivy League champions, Pennsylvania. Fran Dumpy's teams are always tough to play against. They will show up, but I think Texas now knows after losing, the conference tournament to Kansas, it's a wake-up call. This team's starting five is as good as any in the country. Look at P.J. Tucker going to the basket. LaMarcus Aldridge was in foul trouble today against Kansas. He is too good not to be a factor in any of these games, and I really think when you look at Danny Gibson and P.J. Tucker, those two guys, the combination of them, make things happen. But Brad Buckman's another guy. With the 2-3 zone, this is a very tough team to play against, and I really think Texas is going to move forward in the NCAA tournament.
I'll tell you what, as a number one seed and the number one overall seed, Duke got a pretty tough road in this Atlanta region. You know, and looking at some of the other regions, I think out of the number one seeds, Duke can argue they might have gotten the toughest road. In the last couple of years, I thought Duke had the easiest road. This year, I think they may have the toughest.
You know, you also got Cal down there. You start looking for stars in the
Leon
tournament.
Poe.
Guys
Leon
that
Poe.
Can
wow.
carry a team through a tournament. Leon Poe was brilliant in the Pac-10 tournament. You also look, with all of the parity we saw in the conference tournaments, at potential upsets. And it was just a year ago that Syracuse went cruising into the tournament, fresh off a Big East championship, and they ran in the tiny little Vermont, the Catamounts, with a couple of veteran players and a wily old coach, Tom Brennan, who's now with us. Tom, as you look at this Atlanta region, who could be the Vermont out of this region?
Well, I'll tell you what, Rece, what jumps out at me is the Iona Gales. Four senior starters, just like we had four senior starters. Stevie Burt, 25 a game. We had Coppenrath at 25 a game. They've been very, very good in their league. I think they got a great shot to win this game, and the irony's not lost on me. It better not be lost on LSU.
Now, Steve Burt Jr. is a high-scoring guy. He's a guy also much like Poe who can take over a game with his offensive ability.
And they've got three lefties on this team. Ricky Soliver, an outstanding defender, was the MAC Defender of the Year. This team can really play. Now, they played Kentucky tough. They've won some quality games this year. I think this is a dangerous team to play against. Steve Burt can absolutely go off. And Gary Springer, remember Steve Burt and Gary Springer, the dads?
Right.
Gary Springer's kid is a heck of a good athlete and starting to really play.
They found some rhythm late in the season, some chemistry.
Davis, let's get serious. Glenn Davis has been a force the last two months of college basketball. He's so tough in the paint. That's what Iona can't handle.
You know, it's going to help him getting, as we mentioned, Tyrus Thomas back. Daryl Mitchell's been a great shooter for them. Hope Dick Vitale will make it in just a little bit. Plenty more on ESPNU's Bracketology.
It's March Madness.
Schools in session.
65 teams, only one lives the dream.
Journey to the tourney.
It's sweet to be elite.
Dance.
Hit the dance floor.
Dance.
Your way to the final four. There's no apology in this finology.
It's March Madness.
Through the bracketology. The heartbreaks and heartaches.
Who makes the rim shake?
A storybook teller.
Watch out.
The Cinderella.
The 12 verse 5.
To a tie.
And stay alive.
No time for sadness.
Is this
March the Madness?
Can you pack it?
ESPN.
Pack it.
And if you can't, let us help you.
Fill in your brackets.
Let our analysis take you from 8 to 4 to 2 to 1.
Bracketology.
A long way from being done.
Dance.
March Madness.
Dance.
March Madness.
Dance.
March Madness.
Dance.
It's March Madness.
With an easy button, but your business does. It's called Staples.
The true fan, the whole year comes down to just one weekend. The 2006 NCAA Men's Final Four. In the biggest ticket giveaway in NCAA history, only Pontiac is sending 100 fans to see it live. You have just one week to get to your Pontiac dealer. Get your ID number, log it in at ncaasports.com/Pontiac, and see if these seats will be yours when the Final Four comes down to just one. Pontiac, official performance machines of the NCAA.
Outlook is calling for intense flooding, followed by the end of the world!
On March 31st, Ray Romano.
I don't think her tree goes.
Sage, the meltdown rated PG. March 31st.
ESPNU Bracketology is presented by Staples. That was easy. And in part by Pontiac, official performance machines of the NCAA.
UConn, the number two overall seed in the NCAA tournament. You think some of the teams that got snubbed had a rough ride? How about Dick Vitale's ride just trying to get here to get back from Greensboro in the ACC tournament? Glad you made it in. Glad you're okay.
Well, thanks, Rece. They couldn't land. It was fog. We had to go to New Haven. I was going to stop at Yale and try to get an education.
Hey, let's take a look at the D.C. bracket now. UConn, the number two overall seed in the tournament. They'll try to work their way toward the regionals in Washington, D.C. They'll open with Albany. And how about that Kentucky-UAB rematch from a second round game a couple of years ago when the Blazers knocked out a top seeded Wildcat team. What about the top half of this bracket, Jay?
Well, I think UConn has a solid road to get all the way to the Final Four with the bracket that they've got. Compelling matchups down on the bottom as well. If the second round, if the top seeds move on to see Illinois and Washington, two really good teams led by great players in Brandon Ward from Washington and D. Brown and James Augustine from Illinois. That Kentucky UAB game should be a great game because different styles. Kentucky's going to have to score against that press and punish UAB for pressing. They didn't do that the last time they met in the NCAA tournament.
Well, if we look at this bracket, the only way Connecticut doesn't get to the Final Four is if they beat themselves, because no one can rebound with them. No one can block shots the way they can. No one has a point guard, maybe D. Williams, but nobody like what you look at Marcus Williams brings today. But Denham Brown has been the guy that's been hot lady. Then his game is the one thing they need to do, that one-on-one guy like Ben Gordon did a couple years ago when they went to the national title game and won the national title. But when you look at what goes on in that front line with Armstrong, Gay, and Boone, they can block shots, they can rebound, they can score in the paint. Rashad Anderson shooting a three, Denham Brown going one-on-one, and Marcus Williams, by far one of the great assist players in the game. This is a solid bracket, and I don't see anybody, Dick, taking care of business. If UConn loses, it's because they beat themselves.
Well, I agree with you guys. I think we've been unanimous all year about how talented Connecticut is. Bottom line, though, is why do they struggle? For example, they struggle with Louisville. I could not believe that. There's no Paget. They struggle. Then they get beat by Syracuse when they're in a situation they go down 15. They really have become enigma. They absolutely are the most talented. They're my choice to win it all. And remember this, no team that's ever lost in the first round of a tournament has won the NCAA tournament. When I say tournament, I mean the Big East. Right, and I love that basketball team's talent.
But I'll tell you what, the first round loss they had was different than in years past. The teams that lost in the Big East tournament years past, were playing more bottom feeders. Now with the bigger Big East, they're playing an NCAA tournament team that first game out of the gate. I'll tell you one thing that could be a problem for UConn, and that's distractions. Mm-hmm. If they had been shipped out west, I think they would have been happier. The last two times that UConn won the national championship in 99, 2004, they did it out of the west where they could get away from distractions, not having to worry about tickets, everybody coming in. Right. That could be a problem.
You know, guys, I also think this, to throw this in, Jay and Digger and Rece, when they won, as you said, in 99 and 2004, they really built off the momentum. They won the Big East championship. Now, some clubs feed off that. Other clubs bounce back after losing. Tom Izzo has done a great job with his club losing in the Big Ten and going on.
All right, and throughout the show, you're seeing the returns on the bottom, how America is voting in the national brackets on ESPN.com. People filling them out, picking winners already in the bottom half of the D.C. bracket. Maybe the stunner of the whole thing, despite Tennessee's slide, Bruce Pearl's team, great turnaround, Jay, but number two seed.
I can't believe that. That had to be they got bumped up a seed line for bracketing purposes. There's no way that Tennessee is considered better than North Carolina, but 2 and 3 really isn't going to make that big of a difference. This is a really solid bottom region. Michigan State can make a run. North Carolina is outstanding. That Wichita State Seton Hall game. How about this? If Seton Hall wins, that's considered an upset. And beware, Tennessee. Winthrop is a really solid basketball team. Terrell Martin is a great athlete. James Shuler is a load. And Craig Bradshaw, 6'10", can shoot it from the perimeter. Greg Marshall's got a team that can beat Tennessee. They beat Marquette this year.
Well, when we look at teams that jump out at you, it's got to be North Carolina. Let's go back to when Carmelo Anthony and Jerry McNamara were freshmen at Syracuse. Well, we got the freshmen playing with the leadership of David Noel, and obviously Hansborough is the force inside that can make things happen. Their perimeter game is strong, but I love that leadership of Roy Williams, who's got the Final Four experience. They won a national title last year. He's taken his young team and done a great job, as has David Noel, who said, guys, when we go to Cameron, you've never played it. I'm going to teach you how to play this game. They're down 13-2. The rest of that game was history, Dick. This is a very dangerous team that has a lot of confidence going into the NCAA tournament.
Well, you know, I just had North Carolina. I can tell you this. They got in a little foul trouble there with Rayshon Terry, and that certainly hurt them. But that club, we keep talking about their youth. First of all, Tyler Hansbrough is 20 years of age, so he's an experienced kind of kid. Bottom line also is David Noel, Terry, and Miller have been so strong for them. They really have. Roy Williams has been our coach of the year nationally. He's done a phenomenal job. I like that club. I like their depth. I like their athleticism, and I like them on the bottom of that draw.
I'll tell you what. I think UConn got the easiest road to the Final Four out of all the number one seeds. I think Duke got the toughest road in the Atlanta region. I think this D.C. region is the easiest road of any number one seed for UConn.
They might have a tougher time in the Sweet 16 with a potential game against a Washington or an Illinois than they would when they got to the Elite Eight game. George Mason was a little bit of a surprise making it in as the second team out of the Colonial, a potential Cinderella team. But Tom, is that the team you look at right now out of the D.C. bracket and say that maybe they could spring a surprise or two?
Not so fast with Washington, Rece Davis. I like the Utah State Aggies. Stu Morrow, one of the underrated coaches in this country. They're the fourth best field goal percentage team in the land. They almost beat Nevada twice. They beat them once in Nevada. Nevada's a fifth seed. If they keep the game in the 60s, they could cause Washington a lot of trouble. Nate Harris is a great player.
All right, Tom will continue to pick out the Cinderellas for us. Villanova, Alan Ray's injury apparently didn't affect the tournament selection committee. We'll show you Villanova's road and see what these guys think of it when we come back.
This is March Madness on wheels. It starts with the Pontiac G6, bringing more power than Mazda 6 and better fuel economy than Nissan Altima. Pontiac Torrent is the only one in its class with both a V6 engine and sport-tuned suspension standard. And each has a price the competition simply can't touch. Google Pontiac and check the stats for yourself. March Madness on Wheels is going on now.
It's the most exciting hole on tour, the 17th at Sawgrass. Now, Tiger, Lefty, Vijay, and Ernie take on the infamous Island Green. The Players' Championship begins Thursday, March 23rd on ESPN.
The journey begins on Selection Monday. From the tournament draw...
I think this is a very dangerous team.
...to the final buzzer.
NCAA champion.
We'll take you there. Women's Basketball Selection Special, Monday at 7 on ESPN.
Just move your way.
The Brew at 105.7. Rock with real variety.
Single white female enjoys shopping, long walks, and cuddling. Will you marry me?
Investing with someone you've never met doesn't make much sense either. That's why Edward Jones prefers meeting clients face-to-face, so you can get investment advice from someone you actually know. Edward Jones, making sense of investing.
Welcome back to ESPNU Bracketology, presented by Staples.
In the Minneapolis bracket, you know, 14 number one seeds have won at Villanova as a national championship. They've never been a number one seed before, but the Wildcats are this time. They'll open play in Philadelphia on Friday against the winner of the opening round game between Monmouth and Hampton. That's a pretty salty number four sitting there in that bracket, JMBC.
Boy, and talk about an anybody can win bracket right here. Villanova, I expect to move on past the first round game, but Arizona, Wisconsin, that's going to be a very difficult game for Arizona because they're playing a style that doesn't turn it over very much, that posts its guards. Bo Ryan has a really good team led by Alondo Tucker. Nevada is a quality team, and it's not just Nick Fizikas that can play. Marcellus Kemp can get it to the rim. Ramon Sessions, an outstanding point guard. They're not a great shooting team, but they're outstanding defensively. And Dick and I were just talking about Boston College. That is a team that should be a higher seed in my judgment. That's a two seed, three seed quality basketball team that's sitting there at a four, ready to beat somebody.
But they don't care because they'd love to play Villanova, because let's go back. This is my Big East bracket, because Boston College, obviously, when you take a look at who's in their bracket down lower, it's going to be Georgetown. But this team, to me, is as good as any team in the country. For them to get 46 to 28 points in the paint against Carolina, 44 to 26 against Duke, this team knows how to go inside. Craig Smith is that good. They are that talented. They started the ACC Conference 0-3, and here they are in that championship game against Duke. I would not want to play these kids. Their style of play, they run that flex offense, not afraid to go inside, make things happen from there. Their defense is solid. And when you take a look at Tyrese Rice, that freshman's not afraid to throw him up now.
I'll tell you guys, I sat there today along with Mike Patrick and also with Doris Burke, and we watched in amazement. This club executes. Their offensive efficiency is absolutely sensational. They play within themselves. Smith in a low box. Dudley, a terrific passer. Rice off the bench. This club, if it weren't for the dramatic performance by J.J. Redick at the end of the game, he pulled a la Mr. McNamara, Mr. Clutch, knocking down some unbelievable threes. This club would have won the ACC championship in their first year. They're my club to play Villanova in the Elite Eight. And when it's all said and done, Boston College is going to Indianapolis.
Wow, a little foreshadowing for the Final Four later.
I'm not sure. Stretch. Villanova's got a tough road just to get to Boston College in the Elite Eight.
That second game, Wisconsin winner.
They're playing against difficult styles. I expect Wisconsin to beat Arizona, but they're going to play against a style that is really tough for them. Remember that Villanova lost to West Virginia, a team that plays a different style, team with very good guards. And the same thing could happen with Boston College, a tougher team that can rebound, get the ball inside, and can handle pressure.
Yeah, I know Boston College in the ACC now, but don't forget Pacific, 2-0 against Big East teams the last 2 years in the tournament. Probably sorry they changed conference affiliations. The bottom of the bracket, I know the selection committee says, oh, we're not clever enough to put together intriguing matchups. How about Billy Donovan against his old buddy John Pelfrey there? Florida and South Alabama in the 3-14 matchup in the bottom half of the Minneapolis region.
Now, don't be surprised. Obviously, these would be upsets, but it is not out of the realm of possibility that Wisconsin-Milwaukee will be playing South Alabama in the second round. Florida and Oklahoma had better be prepared for fights, because Wisconsin-Milwaukee played very well last year. They've got Joa Tucker back, Adrian Tigert, an outstanding passer, Boo Davis. That's a quality basketball team. Then at the bottom of that bracket, Georgetown, North Northern Iowa is going to be an intriguing basketball game. Northern Iowa did not play well down the stretch, but they beat LSU. They beat Iowa. That's a good basketball team. And Davidson has got the kind of team that is old enough and experienced enough to beat Ohio State, or at least give them a very difficult time.
Well, let's stay in the Big East, because the Big East really has shown how good these teams can be. Georgetown is that good. Why? Roy Hibbert has really increased his game to where he's become one of the best big men in the country. We know what Brandon Bowman can do and Jeff Green. And I really think Ashante Cook is doing a great job of running the team. The style of play, you don't want to play them man-to-man, because they're just going to run you off screens, look to go inside, outside, and their defense is that solid. This is a very talented Georgetown team. John Thompson III's done a great job coaching this team. And when I talk about the Big East bracket, this is where I look at a Boston College, what? Maybe a Georgetown matchup for that regional championship.
Well, you know, you talk about parity across college basketball. It's running rampant. I really believe that Pete Rozelle, that theory he had in the NFL, has arrived in college basketball. All these teams can beat one another. As Jay alluded to, all those clubs he talked about, from Davidson, Northern Iowa, on any given day, shooting the three, they execute well, they all have good perimeter players. In college basketball, big guys run to the NBA if they're superstars. Therefore, the game has become guard-dominated. And if you're strong on a perimeter, and a lot of these mid-majors are, I'm telling you, you can have Shock City. Guys, I looked at the draw for the first time. This is the first time I'm really looking at the draw. I can't believe some of these teams I see in here, and I don't see. Where's Cincinnati?
But they're not. You're not going to see them.
I mean, well,
we'll
I see Utah
that.
State's
we'll
Air Force.
Talk about that
what
in
happened?
Just a little while.
Unbelievable.
You know, 80% of the people thinking Georgetown is going to beat Northern Iowa. Remember, they beat LSU. They beat Iowa
early
during
the
regular season. But the number one seed in that Minneapolis region, Andy Katz, is Villanova. The problem for the Wildcats, how healthy is Allen Ray? You've been following the story all weekend since he had the eye injury in the Big East tournament against Pittsburgh. What's the latest?
Well, Villanova released a statement earlier on Sunday saying that Allen Ray has been cleared for non-contact activity. He was actually told to basically rest when he got back to Philadelphia on Saturday. Now he can do non-contact activity. He's going to see an eye specialist on Monday. And then they said after that, they expect him to be cleared to participate in practice and play in games later this week in the NCAA tournament. They let the tournament selection committee know this on Saturday, which is par for the course. They want up-to-date injury information. Rece?
All right, Andy, didn't affect their seeding. Also important, Villanova doesn't play until Friday, so even though the injury not nearly as serious as it could have been, at least they have an extra day to get Allen Ray to feeling a little bit better. All right, Tom Brennan joins us now. He is the man with the Cinderella slippers. Who are you putting it on in this bracket there, Tom?
I'll tell you what, Rece, I agree with what you guys were talking about a little earlier. South Alabama Jaguars can really give Washington some trouble. They play 11, or Florida, excuse me, they play 11 deep. They really get after it. They're the best three-point shooting team in that league. They have two of the top five, top three-point guys, and more importantly, John Pelfrey goes back to his roots as an assistant in Florida. He'll know every single thing they're going to do, and they can really cause a lot of trouble for the Gators.
Be an intriguing matchup for sure, Tom. We'll look forward to that. How about George Washington? Lose a couple of games, all of a sudden you're in that 8-9 matchup. Carl Hobbs going to state his case when we come back.
A heroic, suspense-filled story. Riveting, eye-popping. ESPN Original Entertainment proudly presents Through the Fire. Premieres next on ESPN.
The world may not come with an easy button, but your business does.
Presented by Cisco. Changing the way people work, live, play, and learn. Innovation. Powered by Cisco.
George Washington rips through the season 26-2. And what's your reward for that? Well, you get an 8-9 matchup in the first round of the Atlanta bracket against UNC Wilmington, a very capable team from the Colonial. And oh, by the way, the number one overall seed in the tournament, Duke, awaits if you can get past that first game. GW head coach Carl Hobbs joining us now. Carl, some people really surprised by the fact that you guys weren't seeded a little bit higher. What did you think of your seed?
Well, I'm not sure exactly what I think of it totally. Haven't exactly sunk it in totally at this point. But last year we had a terrific season. We had some great wins. We won the regular season. Then we won our tournament, and we were a 12th seed. So this year with eighth seed, so just like our program, every year we have improved. And now we can say we improved now in the seedings.
How big a factor do you think it was to the tournament selection committee that Pops Mensah-Bonsu, your fine interior player, has been injured? You expect to have him back, but how big of a factor do you think that was in your seeding?
Well, I think it had to play a factor when you look at what we've done and the consistency at which we have won at and the excellence of my basketball players, particularly in our league, to go undefeated, to be one of three programs to ever do that. And obviously, Pops is such an impact player. He makes a difference, a major difference in our success. And so if they took that in consideration, I most certainly can understand that.
And how healthy is Pops right now?
Well, I think there was a rumor that he was seen sprinting past the White House this morning at 6:30. So I hope that rumor is true. but no, he's really rehabbing. He's been very aggressive with his workouts. We'll have a better sense tomorrow. But I'm obviously optimistic. I think we will have him on Thursday, and hopefully he'll be able to have an impact on the game.
Carl, you guys lost to Temple in the Atlantic 10 tournament. How do you think that loss affected your team?
I'm not sure just yet. Anytime you play against a John Chaney coach team and you only have one day to prepare, it's very, very difficult. But I'm going to take the positive side. I think the rest, mentally and physically, will bode well for us. And also, I think it takes a little bit of pressure off us going into the tournament.
All right, Carl, it's been a terrific season for you. Thanks so much for spending some time with us, and best of luck against UNC Wilmington the rest of the way in the tournament.
Hey, thanks for having me on, guys.
All right, Carl Hobbs, the head coach at GW, the former UConn assistant. Carl was diplomatic. What did you think, Jay, of GW seed?
I think the seed was just fine. I think they're a very good team, not a great team. But they played a poor non-conference schedule. If you don't play anybody in the non-conference, you're not going to be seeded that high. They really haven't proven that they can beat anybody. They beat Maryland. Maryland is outside of the top 50. They beat Xavier when Xavier was strong. That was a quality win. Outside of that, I'm not sure that George Washington can boast any quality wins that they can really rely upon to say, hey, we're better than an 8 seed.
I'll tell you one thing. The danger there is if they look ahead to Duke, they could be in trouble in a game with North Carolina Wilmington coming out of the Colonial. The Colonial was an underrated conference. They got some great guards in Carter and Goldsberry, and they can play. Brownell's done a great job with that club, and that is a game. I'm telling you, I would not be shocked in any shape or form if they win that basketball game over George Washington.
The shock is you play a great season all year long, and you know, you're climbing the top 10, you're moving up in the polls, moving up, and all of a sudden you see this, and you got to go, we're 8-9. And being a coach that's gone through that, you know, you just say to yourselves, all right, will it have an impact on us? That's the one thing you got to regroup and practice is forget all this stuff, get ready for Wilmington, and just play.
You always like to be the underdog. 8-9 is a perfect line for you. You always then wanted to be behind, sneak around and beat somebody.
I see Duke next single.
You want to be a higher seed then, don't you?
<That's right. laughs> I really do think the committee looked at Pops, you know, Mensah-Bonsu. I think his injury really dropped them a little bit in their mind because, you know, how effective is he going to be coming back so quick?
Hasn't played in a month.
Hasn't played.
Yeah, you know, number one seeds, it could be in some trouble, perhaps. You know, you start looking around and say, okay, which number one seed you want to pick to lose? You guys thinking UConn's going to win the national championship.
Wow.
The people out there, ESPN.com and the Sports Nation poll, they think the Huskies will be the first.
There are votes from Carolina. Those Carolina votes coming in from the Duke and Carolina fans.
Are you saying this wishful thinking?
Yeah, right.
Duke fans?
Good luck with
logging
that.
On?
Oh, wow.
Worldwide web? Memphis is another number one seed. Some believe that they are vulnerable. We'll show you the Oakland bracket and where the Tigers fit in and who might be a challenge to them.
Bracketology, presented by Staples.
Rich basketball heritage for Memphis, but for the first time in program history, they are a number one seed. They'll open play in Dallas on Friday against Oral Roberts out of the Mid-Con. And if they get past that, how about this? potentially Arkansas and Dallas. They'll be calling some serious hogs in there in that crowd. They're like a road game for Memphis.
And that's a bear of a 16 seed in Oral Roberts to have to play. I think that Oral Roberts with Caleb Green and Kenny Tutt, that's a team that can beat Memphis. I'm not saying they will, but they can beat them. In Arkansas, as you guys know, very athletic with Ronnie Brewer. They've got shot blocker Stephen Hill, can send shots back. That could be an interesting game, but Bucknell is not going to be an easy out for Arkansas.
Well, we talk about Carolina and the job that Roy Williams did with that team, but how about Bill Self with this Kansas team? They lose 2 weeks ago by 15 to Texas at Texas, but come back today and get it done in what I call a payback game. They're very solid. Mario Chalmers can get it done. Brandon Rush can get it done. The thing they've improved on, they're not turning the ball over like they did earlier in the season, and more importantly, they know each other. They play together well, and today they just put on a clinic, I thought, against Texas to steal that win and win the Big 12 Conference Tournament. This is another very dangerous team, Dick, because of their youth. Forget it. They've grown up now by winning that Big 12 Conference Tournament.
They got three diaper dandies that can flat out play. Rush is absolutely sensational, and Bill Self, the job he has done. I mean, they were 3-4 at one time, and I think there might have been some thinking in the middle of the season, possibly. NIT, forget about being a number 4 seed and winning the Big 12 Tournament Championship. An amazing job. I think next year, along with North Carolina, the two best teams, but we want to get ahead of ourselves. I will tell you this.
Who's going to be on the cover of your magazine next year already?
Oh my God. Memphis doesn't want to play during a regular season. Arkansas, neighbor, now they may get him in that second round, but Jay's right. Bucknell could spoil that matchup. And I think when you look at Memphis, I love their youth. I love their talent. I think they played a dynamite pre-conference schedule. That matchup with Arkansas, if they play, could be one heck of a battle because Ronnie Brewer is a game player. He's a guy that makes plays. Not a great shooter, but he makes plays. And I think they want to welcome that challenge to play Memphis.
But what's going to happen to Memphis? They're going to miss the fact that last year when we saw Louisville get to the Final Four. Why? Because they played against Cincinnati, Marquette, DePaul, and Memphis themselves. Those five teams play. So now you don't have that. This may catch up to them to now because they have not had a tough schedule at the end of the year.
Hey, you think that he's laughing a little bit? I remember Calipari saying, all those guys ran to the Big East. I told them, mediocrity, baby, and I'm going to be here. He's a number one seed. You were right, Calipari.
Yeah, I thought Bilas was going to call for the Oral Roberts Bucknell second round game. Come on, Jay. Step up. Call it.
You want upsets going? You want upsets now?
Not yet. Not yet.
Expect a miracle. Or what?
The Indiana Hoosiers.
A little controlled excitement for Indiana. The Hoosiers knew that they were going to be in the field of 65 after bouncing back after Mike Davis announced that he would resign effective at the end of the season. Davis said his team played much looser, and Indiana is the sixth seed. They'll play in Salt Lake City on Thursday against a very capable, very dangerous San Diego State team. Gonzaga getting the 3 seed in the Oakland region.
About where we expected Gonzaga to be. I didn't think they were good enough to be a 2. Indiana, dangerous. San Diego State, Brandon Heath, Marcus Slaughter, Muhammad Abukar. That's a quality and capable team. I still think Indiana's going to move along. Most intriguing game, Marquette against Alabama. Ronald Steele, one of the top 5 point guards in the country. Jamario Davidson, one of the best big guys in the country, an outstanding rebounder, going against Dominique James, the freshman of the year in the Big East, and Steve Novak can really shoot it. Watch out for UCLA. Their guard tandem is good enough to compete with anybody.
I think UCLA, now knowing what Ben Howland wants as a coach, had really come together. Offensively, defensively, Ben Howland has brought this team the Big East mindset that he had at Pittsburgh. They're physical, they're aggressive, they get up and down the floor, and I love the way Jordan Farmer runs this team. This is going to be a very dangerous team when you look at this bracket, especially when they can really, I feel, move up if they get Marquette in the next matchup. I think that this UCLA team is a team that can move forward and make it to that regional championship and pull it off, Dick.
I'll tell you guys, I agree with Jay and I agree with you. That backcourt is sensational. Flalo and Farmer is phenomenal. In tournament play, guard play is essential. And I love Ben Howland. Look at the job he did at Pittsburgh. I mean, he set the tone for Pittsburgh, and he's done it here at UCLA. In fact, I have them picked as one of my clubs to go to the Final Four. I really love UCLA's guard play. I think there's so much emphasis on guard play at tournament time, and they're my pick to come out of that region.
I think this region is set up
better for Kansas. I like Kansas's path to get to the Final Four out of this region. The toughest game they're going to have is Pittsburgh, because Pittsburgh, big, strong, deep, and experienced. That's the kind of team that Kansas can have a problem with. But Kansas, so good defensively. Their younger guys getting better and better. They're getting scoring out of Mario Chalmers. Julian Wright is turning into a star before our very eyes, and they can put in big guys. They can play different lineups. I like Kansas to get all the way to Indianapolis.
Hey, Jay, I'll tell you this, Darren. It's a really interesting matchup, and I just glanced down here. I can't believe Pittsburgh, a number six seed, though. That's a very dangerous basketball team. With Krauser and company and Gray getting better and better, they're my sleeper out of that region. I really believe they're a Rip Van Winkle. Now, I really like that Pittsburgh.
If Carl Krauser's not shooting the ball, they got issues. And when you saw how they lost their last two games before the Big East, but now wait a second. When they lose, Carl Krauser's the reason why they lost to Seton Hall as well as West Virginia. And those games where he goes 5 for 26, they don't make it work. And that's what happened in that Big East Conference tournament. He and Gray didn't play well, even though they beat Villanova. And if that doesn't happen, they don't show up, Pittsburgh's going to have issues.
Pittsburgh in that always dangerous 5-12 matchup against Kent State. The Panthers know Kent State a little better than they want to. Kent State knocked out a higher-seeded Pittsburgh team in 2002, the year that the Golden Flashes went to the Elite Eight. Kent State, maybe somebody else, Tom Brennan. Let's fit somebody out of the Oakland region for a Cinderella slipper. Who is it?
I'll tell you, fellas, in the Oakland region, I really like San Diego State. Every game might be Mike Davis's last. That might affect Indiana a little bit. They have a Hall of Fame, not a Hall of Fame coach, but a coach who's won a national championship in Steve Fisher. Jay said, they have three great players, obviously Slaughter and Heath. Some people think can be pros. They've won 16 of 18. But more importantly, here's the nugget. Every one of their Mountain West games on the road is in altitude. This game is in Salt Lake City. Now, we played Arizona in Salt Lake City 3 years ago. I couldn't breathe. I was sitting on the bench. But a lot of people say that's because Lute Olson was sitting on the other bench. That's subject to debate.
So San Diego State coming out of the Mountain West Conference. Air Force also able to do it. There are other teams who are feeling a little bit snubbed right now. Look at these bubbles that burst here. Some big teams from some big conferences. Dick, you've been itching to hit this. Cincinnati, to me, is the biggest surprise.
Yeah, Cincinnati really a surprise. I think that the one thing is I have a problem with is we're supposed to pick the 34 best at-large teams. 34 best at-large. That's what's always told us. Maybe I'm wrong, Jay and Digger. Isn't that the rule? The 34 best at-large teams. No one can convince me then, if you're supposed to pick the 34 best at-large teams, that Cincinnati's not part of it. I mean, Cincinnati, to me, even when you look, I know certain schools didn't play great pre-conference schedules, but I'd like to see some of those teams that got in the tournament play in the Big East, play in the ACC, play in the Big Ten, and go 9-7 and go 8-8. I mean, I think it's a subjective feeling. It's not objective. And I think if you're going to reward teams for a great year, I have no problem. But tell us that. Don't tell us you're picking the best 34 at large. Reward kids if they have a phenomenal year. You could say, we want to do that. And I have no problem with it.
And let's talk about South Carolina, because I remember the year when Florida State was 6-10 and they got into the NCAA tournament coming out of the ACC. When you look at South Carolina, what have they done lately? They knocked off Tennessee and Kentucky. What else did they do during the season? They beat Florida twice. And we saw how they played today against Florida. They, to me, were one of the teams when I see nothing against Air Force getting in, I got to say, Air Force, South Carolina, no comparison.
Well, you know, South Carolina has lost 15 games. No at-large team has ever lost more than 14. South Carolina, that resume might pale in comparison to the Wolverines, Jay.
Well, the two teams that I think got jobbed, and absolutely jobbed when you compare them to UAB, Air Force, George Mason, are Michigan and Missouri State. And let's start with Michigan. Three wins against the top 25. They beat Illinois, Wisconsin, Michigan State. They beat Minnesota twice. They were 8-8 against in the Big Ten. They had 10 wins against the top 100. They played a really challenging non-conference schedule against teams like UCLA. They won on the road at Notre Dame. They won at South Florida. I mean, this team should have been in the NCAA tournament over teams like Air Force, George Mason, and UAB. And Missouri State, that was absolutely not the right thing to do, to leave Missouri State out of the tournament if you're going to put in a team like UAB, if you're going to put in Air Force, who beat absolutely nobody. Now, Air Force did beat Miami, and they did beat Georgia Tech, but those are teams that are ranked way outside the top 50. And this Missouri State team did everything that was asked of them. Their worst loss was at Arkansas. Everything else they did, they played well against their schedule non-conference. They beat Wisconsin-Milwaukee. They beat Oral Roberts, and they did very well in the Missouri Valley Conference. That wasn't right.
I'll tell you also, they won 8 out of their last 10 games. I think when you look at that situation, Coalition, and I mentioned Cincinnati. They only beat LSU. They beat Syracuse at Syracuse. They go 8-8 in the toughest conference in America. I don't care about RPIs. I got the VBDI, the Ball Dome Index, and there's certain clubs got a raw deal if you're saying take the top 34. You know, Air Force, little patriotic, guys. I mean, that's a great bunch of kids. Great bunch of kids.
You know, that Missouri State thing is going to set a record for the highest RPI of a team ever left out of the tournament, though the RPI formula has been changed just a little bit. When we come back on Bracketology, we will show you our picks, who the guys think will make it to Indianapolis and go on and win the national championship. Also show you what the nation thinks on our ESPN.com poll. Big East bringing home eight, setting a record. Of course, it's sort of like the Big East and Old Conference USA together. You see the Missouri Valley setting a record. They had never gotten more than three teams into the tournament. The Colonial getting in at large bid this year. What do you think of the number of the conference breakdown, Dick?
Well, you know, I really think Missouri Valley should have had five. I thought Missouri State had won eight of their last 10 games. Certainly belonged in. That was another criteria. How do you finish? They win eight out of their last 10, and yet they don't get in a tournament. And I thought the Big East should have had nine instead of eight. I really believe that. I think when you look at Florida State, I had a problem with their pre-conference schedule. Yes, they did go 9-7. Yes, they did lose a heartbreaker to Duke. I mean, when you look at all those factors, but their pre-conference schedule, the message for Florida State has to be loud and clear. Go out and schedule people in your pre-conference. This is an example why they're not in the NCAA tournament.
As one thing the committee has been very consistent in, when a team gets on that bubble like Florida State did, they penalize them if that schedule's that bad. It happens year in and year out.
Yeah, you get that argument going, but now the ACC expands, and when you look at them expanding, you think, well, all right, you're going to get five or six, and that doesn't happen. But I think when you play in your conference, I've got to give more respect for teams playing in their conference, like what Jay says about a Michigan, and what you can do to try to win in your conference games, and that's what's more important to me than what's going on in non-conference, because when you look at the expanded conferences, it's obvious that the ACC and the Big East have expanded bigger and stronger than anybody else. But when you look at the Pac-10, all right, they get their four, and that's what they've been getting over the years. The Big 12, because it had a Kansas, a year when the Big 12 was not as strong as it's been, they end up with four. But there's no argument when you take a look at who got what, where, when, how. The arguments were some of the teams we talked about, the UABs, the Air Forces, and the Utah State.
See, I don't look at it by conference breakdown. I don't care how many teams come from a conference.
I agree with them.
This is about individual teams. And I'll tell you what, I'm not sure that I agree that the committee is sending a consistent message. I don't think they have sent a consistent message. When they send UAB to the tournament, UAB hasn't beaten anybody in the non-conference, nor played anybody, that sends an inconsistent message. When they send Texas A&M at the expense of other teams that have played people in the non-conference, that is wrong. The same thing with Air Force and Utah State. Those are shaky teams in at the expense of some teams that really prove they deserve
it. You know, maybe a better way to put it is they send the message to certain power conference teams every now and then. And it's happened to several. It happened to Florida State this time. Hubert Davis now joining us, great former Tar Heel in North Carolina. Hubert, guys make their star power in the NCAA tournament. Who are some guys you're watching in this year's tournament?
Well, it's time to step up, and I have four players that I think are going to have outstanding NCAA tournaments, starting off with Ronald Steele from Alabama. Rece, I know you like that. He's been huge in conference play with the injury to Chuck Davis. Stepped up his play, 16 points a game, 43% from three-point range, 4.5 assists, and as a point guard, he really understands when to turn it on offensively and distribute. Brandon Heath from San Diego State, Mountain West Player of the Year, 19 points a game, 41% from three-point range. Not only a shooter, he can get to the hole. Came up big in overtime against Wyoming. And then Nate Harris from Utah State. Coach Stu Moore, undersized power forward, but he can get it done. Moves well without the ball. 17 points a game. 7 rebounds a game. He's huge for Utah State. And then J.P. Batista. It's not only the Adam Morrison show. They have a guy that can throw it down low in the post. He's absolutely fantastic running the floor. I think he's one of the best power forwards in the country. When he gets the ball down low, he can score with either hand, and he is dominant. He hurt his leg in the WCC final. It's going to be interesting to see if he's 100%. If he does, I think Gonzaga can go to a Final Four. And Coach Phelps, I like that Carolina blue tie.
What about Wes Miller? You didn't put Wes Miller on your list. Where's Wes Miller?
That is the Siemens Trophy that will go to the national champion. How about a different day for Nate Harris? Missed a shot to win a conference tournament. Now he's a player to watch.
Is presented by Staples. That was easy. And in part by State Farm. Great service, great rates. That's why 40 million drivers trust State Farm.
Throughout the show, you've been able to see who America thinks is going to advance in the opening round games. Now, this is what America thinks in the national poll as far as who's going to make it to the Elite Eight, onto the Final Four, and win the national championship. Duke and Texas in a rematch of a Duke blowout in the regular season. Memphis and Gonzaga in Oakland. UConn and North Carolina in that D.C. bracket. And then Villanova and Ohio State in the Minneapolis bracket. America is voted on ESPN.com on the Sports Nation poll. Duke and the Zags in the Final Four, along with Connecticut and Villanova, and then Duke and UConn for the national championship. A rematch of some great classic games. And though some people in the early going Husky Nation has gotten out and started voting, 41% earlier said UConn would be the first one seed out. Now Husky Nation's alive. They've got UConn winning the national championship. What do you think, Digger? Let's go 8-4, 2-1.
Well, let's just start out with this premise. The last 3 years, only four number one seeds out of 12 made it to the Final Four. Eight didn't get there. So when I talk about brackets and we talk about how we go after it, here's who I think is going to end up when I look at my Elite Eight. I think that's not my picks, is it?
Yes.
Yeah.
Digger's picks.
Digger's picks. Yeah. Duke and Texas.
I got Texas.
He's running away already.
No. I got Texas beating Duke.
You can't change your mind.
I got UCLA beating Kansas. I really think UConn's on a mission, but I love Boston College because now they're back into the Big East playing the Huskies. But I think the Huskies and Texas meet in that championship game, and I'm going with the Huskies to win it all.
Yikes, that was pretty good. And it was all news to you.
Yeah, all news to me.
He was shocked. I think he was shocked with his picks.
That's my picks. Wow.
Just wait till Thursday. He'll change his mind anyway.
That was better than watching the game.
He will change three times. I will hear you on the radio.
He just changed now.
USA Today.
No, I like
it. See three different changes. three national titles.
Well, I'm going with a little more chalk. I don't have Gonzaga like the fans do, but let's take a look at my seeds heading on into the Elite Eight. I'm going to have Duke and Texas, the chalk going into the Elite Eight from that region. I like Kansas and Marquette. I know that doesn't go according to seed, but I like the way those brackets set up for those two teams. I'm going to go with Connecticut and North Carolina, what should have been the 1 and 2 seeds in the D.C. region. And then down low, I'm going with Villanova and Georgetown. Now, Georgetown has a difficult road, but I like the way they defend. Connecticut and Villanova, that can be a rematch of the classics that we saw the first two times those teams played. And then Duke and Kansas, a little rematch of the 91 national title game. I've got Duke and Connecticut in the title game. I'm going with Connecticut from the first dribble in practice. I said Connecticut was the best team. I'm sticking with the Huskies. I think Connecticut is going to win the national championship. I think they're primed for it.
I'll tell you one thing. Great picks right there. I was trying to do mine in a taxi as we're flying from the airport, trying to get here. Howie Schwab screaming at me about picks. So let's see what I picked, because I don't know what I picked. Let's take a look right here. I got Duke and Texas. I'll tell you, Duke and Texas right here in a good matchup again, a rematch. And then I have Memphis and UCLA. I like the Tigers, but I love UCLA. Connecticut and Boston College. I got Duke and UCLA in one matchup. Connecticut and Boston College. Ultimately, Duke and Connecticut battle again. National title. Cut the nets down. Celebrate. Stores Connecticut. Celebration. Jim Calhoun. Hey, Jim, we all picked you. That means you're losing in the first round.
You know, the top two overall seeds in the tournament, you guys think you're going to get to the national championship game. Well, some of you do, not all of you. And for all the issues you have with the committee, maybe at least they got the top two overall seeds right. It's been a great run through the season. We're getting set to start the tournament Tuesday night on ESPN HD. The opening round game, Monmouth and Hampton. For all of these guys, Dick Vitale, Jay Bilas, Digger Phelps, Andy Katz, Tom Brennan, Hubert Davis, I'm Rece Davis. Thanks for watching ESPNU's Bracketology. We'll be with you throughout the tournament.